Hi, my name is William Hucker, and I am a cardiac electrophysiologist at the Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston, Massachusetts. And I'm here today to talk to you about anticoagulation in atrial fibrillation. The key takeaways from this talk are to identify appropriate candidates for anticoagulation in AFib, to review the appropriate use of the CHADS2-VAS score in determining which patients need anticoagulation. We'll review the bleeding risk associated with anticoagulation and how to address these concerns with patients. And we'll also debunk the need for routine periprocedural anticoagulation in AFib patients. So the treatment of atrial fibrillation is often divided into two pieces. One is rate versus rhythm control, which we will not talk about in this talk, but we'll focus on stroke and systemic embolism prevention. There are a few ways to try to mitigate this risk for patients who have AFib. The pharmacologic ways would be with anticoagulation, and that can be with either warfarin or other vitamin K antagonists. The DOACs are direct oral anticoagulants, or a heparin product like low molecular weight heparin. There are also non-pharmacologic ways of trying to prevent strokes in patients with AFib, and that includes a left atrial appendage occlusion, which is an endovascular catheter-based procedure. There's also surgical ways, such as the left atrial appendage amputation. However, those non-pharmacologic ways won't be covered in this talk. We can't discuss oral anticoagulation in AFib without a brief discussion of risk stratification for AFib. Two different patients can have AFib for the same amount of time and have a very different risk of stroke, as stroke risk really depends not only on the AFib, but also how likely is that patient to form a clot while in AFib, and this depends on many different factors. The most clinically useful risk stratification scheme is called the CHADS-VAS score, and that's listed here. Each letter in the acronym correlates with a different condition that the patient may have. The C is for congestive heart failure, H for hypertension, A is for age, and the patient gets 1 point if their age is between 65 and 74, or 2 points if they're over 75. D is for diabetes, S is for a prior stroke or TIA. Vascular refers to any vascular disease that the patient has, and gender provides another point for female patients. The CHADS-VAS score can be used to roughly predict a patient's annualized risk of a stroke or systemic embolism. This was nicely demonstrated in a very large Swedish registry study of patients diagnosed with AFib but not exposed to warfarin in the 6 months prior to the study or during the study period. They identified over 140,000 patients and then quantified their thromboembolic risk. And they used a broad definition of thromboembolism as seen in the chart here. They looked at stroke, TIA, pulmonary embolism, or an otherwise unnamed systemic embolism. And you can see that as the CHADS-VAS points, as the CHADS-VAS score increases for patients, their stroke risk increases significantly, with an annualized stroke risk up to 10 to 12% just for stroke in patients with the highest CHADS-VAS scores. You can also see that there's a slight inflection point between a CHADS-VAS score of 1 and a CHADS-VAS score of 2. And the authors made the point to compare female patients with a CHADS-VAS score of 1, which would then just be for gender, versus men who had a separate extra risk factor for stroke. And women had a lower stroke risk of about 0.1 to 0.2% in this study versus men, where there were about 0.7 to 1.3. So guideline recommendations for anticoagulation have taken that into account and suggest that gender alone does not convey excess risk in the absence of other risk factors. So revised AFib guidelines say to consider non-gender risk factors when deciding about anticoagulation. So that means a CHADS-VAS score of 0 in men or 1 in women means that it's reasonable to omit oral anticoagulation for those patients because they're at very low risk for stroke. With a CHADS-VAS score of 1 for men or 2 for women, oral anticoagulation may be considered. And if the CHADS-VAS score is 2 or greater for men or 3 or greater for women, those patients should probably be anticoagulated. Anticoagulation should also be considered for patients regardless of their type of AFib. So that means that you should use the CHADS-VAS score to determine anticoagulation and not whether or not the patient has paroxysmal AFib or persistent or permanent AFib. A corollary to that is that atrial flutter should be treated with anticoagulation just like atrial fibrillation is, because the thrombotic risk or the thromboembolic risk of atrial flutter is similar to that of AFib. Once the decision is made regarding anticoagulation, direct oral anticoagulants, or DOACs, are recommended over warfarin in the updated guidelines. And this recommendation is based on multiple randomized controlled trials that showed at least non-inferiority to warfarin, or in some cases, superiority in the case of apixaban, to the DOAC medications over warfarin in preventing stroke or systemic embolism or complications of major bleeding. In this data from the Aristotle trial, you can see that stroke and systemic embolism prevention was superior with apixaban over warfarin, and major bleeding was less likely to happen with apixaban over warfarin. And this data, combined with the data from other randomized controlled trials, has led to the recommendation that DOACs be used over warfarin for nonvalvular AFib. This then begs the question, what is valvular AFib? That is a very complicated question and has been different in different studies. However, the current guidelines for AFib define valvular AFib as moderate to severe mitral stenosis or the presence of a mechanical valve. That does not include a repaired valve or mitral regurgitation. So in patients that have moderate severe mitral stenosis or they have a mechanical valve, in those patients with AFib, warfarin is the recommended anticoagulant for those patients and not a direct oral anticoagulant. Whenever a patient has AFib and the decision is made to start anticoagulation, one must be prepared to discuss the bleeding risk of the anticoagulant with the patient. Patient concerns regarding bleeding risk are a common reason for underutilization of anticoagulation and therefore need to be addressed. Patients often wonder what their risk of bleeding is if they start anticoagulation. There are clinical calculators to facilitate that discussion, such as the HAS blood score. However, many of the factors that are in the HAS blood score are also in the CHADS-VASc score, meaning that many patients who are at high risk of stroke are often at high risk of bleeding, and it's difficult to weigh those two issues for patients. It's important for patients to know that there are reversal agents available now for all direct oral anticoagulants, so that if there is a bleeding problem, the medication can be reversed. And I think part of the discussion has to be around the consequences of a bleeding event for a patient versus a stroke, because that's an important concept for the patient to know to make an informed decision. For instance, the consequences to their health long-term of a GI bleed are very different than if they've had an embolic stroke, potentially. When addressing this bleeding risk with patients, I often mention the Averroes trial. And the Averroes trial was published in 2011, and they randomized 5,500 AF patients who were not warfarin candidates at the time, for one reason or another. And they randomized them to aspirin versus Eliquis, or apixaban. They looked at the incidence of a stroke or systemic embolism, and they also looked at major bleeding events as outcomes. And what the trial showed is that the chances for a stroke or systemic embolism were much lower in the apixaban group, which is not surprising. However, they showed that the major bleeding events between the two groups were actually the same. So I use that to tell patients that if they were willing to take an aspirin without worrying about the bleeding complications from that, that Eliquis, when trialed against aspirin, actually had the same amount of bleeding complications as just taking aspirin. And I use that as a data point for patients to consider truly what their bleeding risk is with starting an anticoagulant. I think it's also important to mention about periprocedural anticoagulation. So many of these patients who have AFib are then on anticoagulation indefinitely, and there will be times where that anticoagulation needs to be interrupted. So stroke and systemic embolism risk in AFib is really measured in an annualized risk. Even the highest CHADS-VASc score patients have an 8 to 10% risk of a stroke per year, not per day. So their daily risk is very low. And therefore, stopping anticoagulation for a day or two around a procedure may not be that risky. And because DOACs, or direct oral anticoagulants, have a relatively short half-life, they usually do not need bridging anticoagulation. In patients that are treated with warfarin, which has a much longer half-life, bridging anticoagulation has often been used. And bridging anticoagulation has been studied in the BRIDGE trial, which was published in 2015. And in that trial, they randomized patients who are undergoing a procedure to either bridging anticoagulation with a heparin product versus no bridging and just stopping their warfarin for 5 days before the procedure and then restarting. And in this trial, they used the CHADS-2 score instead of the CHADS-VASc score. And the average CHADS-2 score of the patient was 2.3. But in this trial, with patients at moderate risk for stroke, they found that there was no benefit to bridging anticoagulation in terms of preventing stroke or systemic embolism, but they did find that bridging anticoagulation was associated with more major and minor bleeding events. So doing bridging anticoagulation for these patients may have caused some harm and did not prove to be helpful for these patients. But keep in mind, these were relatively low CHADS-2 score patients. So in conclusion, the prevention of stroke and systemic embolism is a vital aspect of AFib management. You should use the CHADS-2-VASc score to determine which patients should be anticoagulated. Direct oral anticoagulants, or DOACs, are recommended in nonvalvular AFib. And be prepared to address the bleeding risk with patients when you start an anticoagulant. Thank you for your time and your attention. I hope you found this video educational.